Well, listen, why don't we get started here? But before I start, I'd like to get a just do a quick poll. How many people would describe themselves as anarchists or anarcho-capitalists here?
Oh, look, I'm just in time for that. Yeah.
And how many people would describe themselves as minarchists for a limited government? All right, so it's fairly even here tonight. At the end of this, I'm going to find out if anyone has changed their mind about their position, and that will determine who was the better debater tonight, I guess. Let's get started with some opening statements. I'm going to keep this fairly informal. I think conversation is good so that they can respond back and forth, but I will have some questions, and I've got a bunch of questions from the audience as well. We won't get to all of them, sorry about that, but I'll try to condense them all together. Sorry, I say that quite a bit. So maybe I'll just start with Robin, since he's been here the longest preparing and has an unfair advantage. And go ahead and just give five. And if you guys could maybe broach the subject, there's a few questions about this. How do you define minarchy and anarchy? Maybe put that into your opening statement as well, the definition, your definition, because I have a feeling that is going to lead to some interesting conversations. Here.
Thank you. I believe that you're all going to make your decision as to whether you're an anarchist or a minarchist based on your definition of those terms. And when I first met Adam a few days ago, and we actually discussed this debate, it was the first time I met him, I started on my problem with anarchism thing, because you're trying to work out the format of this debate. And when I was done explaining the problem with anarchism, he turned around and said, well, you're obviously an anarchist to me. So my honest feeling about this is it is going to come down to definitions, right? Now here's my disclaimer. Despite the 50-50 poll we just had, and I'm a little relieved about that, being a minarchist in a minarchist-anarchist debate at the Libertarian Party convention is like being a Hillary supporter at a Bernie rally, right? So I just wanted to be clear, that I'm doing this because I've been asked to be. Asked to do it. Kierkegaard said, if you label me, you negate me. That's how I feel about both labels, anarchism and minarchism, right? That's my honest feeling. So as not to prejudice any future run I may make as a libertarian for any office, because I may be asking for your support. So now I am fully qualified up.
First, we know you're biased. That's good.
Yes. Yeah. Indeed. Thank you. So look, here's one definition in a loose sense of anarchism that I think Adam might be tending towards based on the speech that you gave over lunch, Adam. So I just want to address that. If you believe that it is in human nature that we are, I will now use a load of new agey language that I believe in, and this may not work for you, but if you believe some equivalent of the following, we are, as human beings, we participate in the divine, in the everything that is. The ultimate reality is love. Love is freedom, is life, is God, if you choose that kind of thing. If you believe all of that, and that our mission in life, as it were, we come here to remember our highest selves, to remember ourselves as divine. If you think that we're all love, that we're all tending to the realization of our highest selves, that an anarchic society is one that you define as one that would reflect that human experience, a kind of higher human experience, i.e. a more highly evolved human experience. If you want to say those people would necessarily have an anarchic society or participate in an anarchic society because they wouldn't want to use force on each other, if you believe that, then that's an act of faith, right? That's a statement of faith about human nature. You're not doing political philosophy at that point, you're doing metaphysics. And I believe Adam did metaphysics on the podium over lunch. Now, here's the giveaway, right? Here's, I'm going to concede the whole thing in 15 seconds, and then I'm going to win it in 30, right? I'm going to concede it in 15 by saying, I happen to agree with that metaphysics. I believe we're all just individuations of the divine. And maybe there is in some other planet where the society just has no force because these ideal, highly evolved beings that we will one day become will just be some society that has no force in it, that is just love, and love doesn't force. And I'm the guy who writes all the articles about liberty. Liberty is the politics of love. I'm the guy with the libertywithlove.com domains and the liberty with love hashtags. So I really do believe that, kind of deep in my soul, and I know I'm dealing with atheists who believe certain things, but just bear with me a minute. Now here's how I'm gonna now, having conceded it, win it back. Like, look. The proposition that Adam said he wanted to defend was that that society, a stateless society, is inevitable by virtue of our human nature. That is an extremely arrogant position to take because it means you know something that you can't possibly know. Not only do you know, well, it's kind of ironic for libertarians. As libertarians, we believe we don't know enough about human nature. I don't know enough about your life, your nature, to know what's best for you, right? So how can I know enough to be able to say that the ultimate goal of all this, necessarily, which means it cannot be any other way, is a society with nothing that anybody within that society recognizes or experiences as a state imposing some kind of aggression on them? The reason you have to be a minarchist is this. You can't be sure about that. The epistemically humble position is a minarchist one, because a minarchist says, I know that a government as small as possible is the best kind of government. Sitting here, we don't know that far ahead in the future of freedom. If we can have a zero government society, right? Or a very small government society. Because we don't know, right? You have to be a minarchist. What do I mean? I'm almost done with this opening statement. If he's right, and you can have a zero government, zero state, zero experience of the state, and that's an important distinction, which I will unpack later, then the minarchist is also right, right? Because the minarchist has got the smallest possible government, which is what he's supporting, and it happens to be zero. If, however, Adam is wrong, if there is something about human nature that we don't know, and you can't quite get there, then Adam is wrong, and I'm still right. Right? So either way, if you are a humble, an epistemically humble human being, which you are because you're in this room as libertarians, you're minarchists. Unless you claim to have the knowledge of God. Over to you.
Wait, we were supposed to do definitions and you played the love card. That's not fair. You win. Like, yeah, you're right. You win. All right. To define anarchy here first, I'd like to address the term itself, because I don't think we should deny it, but we should understand it and use better messaging. With all due respect to Rothbard, the originator of what most of us subscribe to as anarcho-capitalism, he took the worst two words possible to describe the most beautiful idea and put them together into one really offensive term, anarcho-capitalism, guaranteed to offend everyone. So, that being said, I will accept the term anarchist as a label, understanding that what I advocate, what I understand, is a subset of that. Obviously, we are not talking about disorder, we are talking about order and harmony. It is the opposite of what that word has been slandered to come to mean. We are talking about voluntarism, specifically the idea that all human interactions should be voluntary. And again, the definitions of this are very important in parsing out the differences. And some of the distinctions made by Robin here, I think are a little specious, but I'm glad that we have gotten down to really the heart of this and how it comes down to human nature and trends and history. And when you say that minarchist is, I will take issue with your definition in a sense. And for the sake of conversation here, no, your definition of your own label is illegitimate, sir. but when you say I'm a minarchist and I believe in the smallest government possible, and if the small that might include that the smallest government possible is no government, then you're really more of an anarcho-agnostic. Right? When you say I'm a minarchist, it means that, as most people apply it, is that it means that you believe in the existence of a state that should be limited by principle. Right? And I think, at least in the short term, in the midterm, in what you see as an ideal that's achievable, I don't think you would take, is that fair? You wouldn't take issue with that, correct? The state should be limited based on ethical and moral principles, and it should be guided by what we subscribe to as a shared set of ethics of the non-aggression principle, correct?
I can't give you a yes or no because I need to come back to your use of the word state.
Agnostic, see? All right. So, one of the things that Robin brought up is about knowledge and predictions and understanding of human nature. And if you understand statism to be coercion, institutionalized coercion, what it requires is an ability for human beings to do violence against other human beings. Without that, the state ceases to be the state. It ceases to be institutionalized coercion without an enforcement class, without people who are willing to do violence against peaceful people on behalf of authority. Now, when you challenge this as a matter of knowledge and human nature, and I actually would cite the historical work of Harvard professor Steven Pinker, who has shown a clear decline in the amount of violence throughout human history. And it's pretty obvious when you stop and think about it, right? Compared to 100 years ago, 1,000 years ago, you can walk down the street a lot more confidently anywhere in the world today in a way that you couldn't. Not that far long ago in human history, it has shown undeniably that this is a very clear trend. Now, I think the burden of proof would be here on Robin to rebut this in order to show that there was a that there would be something. You'll get your time. You would have to show that there would be some factor that would disrupt this trend. This very clear, beautiful trend that is rooted in human nature, not just the statistics of a Harvard professor, which simply backs up the fact that as human beings, we naturally know to prefer harmonious, nonviolent, productive relations over violent, coercive relations. The market naturally prefers relationships that are more productive than less productive. The market progresses. The market seeks better information and better solutions. And whether you think it's limited today by the government or not, we still have a free market in most of our human interactions. Most human interactions are not based on coercion. Most of you live like anarchists. You didn't get up this morning and point guns at people for your salaries. You didn't go beat people up and steal their stuff because you feel like it. It is a normal ethical principle. And humanity is actually progressing and is continuing to get less and less violent. And all of the underpinnings of the state, of disinformation, of dehumanization of the enemy, as I experienced as a US Marine and how I was conditioned and propagandized to think of the Iraqi people, we are overcoming this. And we are actually seeing it accelerate as technology accelerates with Moore's Law, tech computing power, doubling every 18 months. But not just that, if you step back and look at the human history, progress of technology, of everything from the wheel to fire to the internet. And now we can actually watch it happen and feel it. This acceleration is happening, and we get to live through this incredible turning point in human history where for the first time we can see so much farther than we have ever seen before in terms of how humanity is changing over the next several decades. That is the timeline upon which this is happening. Communications technology, productivity, understanding, communication, information awareness, all of these factors conspire to keep human beings progressing towards a state of less violent and rendering the state obsolete.
All right, Robin, do you want to respond to that? Okay.
Of course I do. So I think I'm actually reporting out to making as good an argument for Minarchy as what I was about to make. Because what he is here to show is that there exists a final point of zero government. And all he just showed for the last 5 minutes is exactly what I would agree with. Is that we have a direction. Yes, we have a direction, and if you want to find out more about how it operates, buy my book if you can keep it. It's doing a special deal here at this, this convention. He's right about everything he said. He's shown that we're moving in a direction of reduced coercion, let's say. I'm generalizing, but that's what we're dealing in generalizations. But the question we have to ask, and what I say is, you don't know, because we're dealing with human nature and free will and so far in the political and temporal future that we just can't see this. Is are we approaching the zero point, the point of anarchy of zero state, linearly, not even linear, are we approaching it so that we hit the line, or are we approaching it asymptotically, so we get ever closer to it? And all I'm saying is, I don't know. He claims to know. So the burden of proof is on him. I'm saying you have to agree with me because you're epistemically humble, because you know the limits of your own knowledge. I'm not making a claim to any specific endpoint. Adam is, and I agree with everything he said. And by the with respect to that, and by the way, there is a problem with the very notion of zero state. Or let's put it this way: you use the words which I was very happy about, institutionalized coercion, right? Now that is exactly the right thing to be considered. Because imagine, there's something called, proving the contrary. Like if you start with an assumption and from it you can prove the opposite of the assumption, then you've disproved the assumption. Right, so let's imagine we have an anarchic society. Everybody in it, all of the institutions of enforcement, let's say based on enforcing property rights, we have shared private property, the principles of private property, for example, but you can substitute whatever the basis for enforcement is, right? It's all voluntary, they're private enforcement agencies in competition, everything you hear from the anarchists, right? Now, somebody is born into that society who was not involved in choosing those institutions. And that person just doesn't believe in this particular conception of private property. And by the way, in most cultures, at most times throughout history, we have not had what is now the American libertarian, very pure notion of private property. In fact, Locke didn't accept the private property, the ideas of private property that are peddled in the libertarian, by the Libertarian Party, that are considered to be the standard notions of private property. Hayek didn't either. Now, I'm not saying Hayek and Locke are right and everyone's wrong. I don't know. What I'm saying is a reasonable person could be born into that society with a different conception of property. And so he's going to walk across your field, because he doesn't believe you can own that field, right? Because when he was born with life, he was born with liberty, he was born pursuing happiness at his mother's breast. But he was not born with a piece of paper saying he owned anything, and neither were you. So he has a different conception of property, and there was a reason why the founder said pursue happiness and not property, and it's related to what I've just said. Now, in that case, he walks across the field, all of these voluntary enforcement agencies enforce private property against him, they're going to punish him, but he's not buying it. Right? To him, it doesn't matter what the rest of the community says about those private, competitive enforcement agencies. He didn't have a hand in creating them, and so he's not volunteering to submit to them. So to him, it is the state. To him, it is institutionalized coercion. Right? So if you're saying, yeah, but it's not the state, because we as libertarians have defined it as not being the state, that's fine for us, but it's not fine for him. So Adam was right that we should be talking about institutionalized coercion. And when you consider that, these anarchic arguments against the state or for the possibility of a zero state are really discussing a distinction without a difference. So the only objection to that is, yeah, but the guy could leave the society. No, the guy can only leave that society and set up on his own. I.e., he's only voluntarily submitted if there's somewhere he can go. But in a world of finite resources where everywhere else there's less free states than the one he's in, there isn't necessarily somewhere you can go. Right? So how can you prove that there is a stable equilibrium that is an anarchic society at any point? I just don't think you can prove it. And if you can't prove it, you're a minarchist, not an anarchist.
All right, before I hand this over to Adam, I'm going to let you respond to that, but I just want to try to wrap my head around what was just said here so that I understand it. So if I understand what Robin is saying, he's saying two things. The first thing is that he seems to think that there's a disagreement, that the main disagreement here is that we can never reach a voluntarist society.
I don't know.
Or that you don't know.
And
so he's saying that we can reach it, you're saying that you don't know, and so that's the disagreement. And then you're also saying that that you can't necessarily call a society anarchic if someone is born into that society with a different conception of property rights or something like that. Would that be fair?
And therefore experiences enforcement as unwarranted aggression.
Okay.
Right?
So
because to him it's a violation of the NAP.
Right, so I'm going to get Adam to respond to that. Maybe Adam, I also get, because one thing I haven't heard yet either is a clear definition of what is anarchy, what is minarchy, what is the state. If you could add that in, and I'd like to hear what Robin has to say about that as well.
The state is a territorial monopoly on the initiation of force. Minarchy is the belief that that institution can be valid and restrained by principle, and anarchy is the belief that it can and it should, and as I would say, absolutely will eventually be eliminated. So one of the things that Robin brings up is these institutions that if you're born under, by the way, I just have to point out that we are not quite too tired to like sound really smart and use really big words, but we are probably too tired to understand most of what each other is saying. So there will be clarifications, that's okay. And feel free to interject, right? I'm saying that on behalf of the moderator. If you're born into a society with certain institutions, if they're not forced on you, then you are not being coerced to participate in them. There are many institutions in society today that exist, that claim property that you're not coerced into. I mean, the AAA, I'm a AAA member. Is anybody here bothered by the fact that that there's this institution that is gonna, in some ways, protect my property rights? Is anybody offended that other people claim private property in this? And I think what Robin is suggesting that if somebody in a voluntary society wakes up and says, wow, gee, I don't really agree with property rights based on self-ownership, I'm just gonna walk across your lawn, I'm just gonna steal your stuff, and I have a different definition of property rights, yeah, you're gonna be aggressed on. I don't think that creates a non-voluntary state, because if there is institutionalized coercion that is not forced upon you simply by virtue of being born in a society, but based on your actions in that society, that's a different circumstance. So the other thing is, what you're doing with this, Robin, is coming up with an excuse for theft. Like, hey, if we have a voluntary society and everybody asserts self-ownership and the non-aggression principle, and someone says, well, I don't really agree that that's your property, therefore you can't coerce me, or therefore this is now a society with institutionalized coercion, I think what you've said is actually we don't have a voluntary society because propertarianism, or however you want to define it, is inherent with voluntarism. It's inherent to self-ownership, that if you own yourself, if you own your body, you have the right to own property outside of your body. So if a socialist is born into a capitalist world, that doesn't mean that they have the right to say, we can just steal from other people and I object or disagree with your concept of property rights. One of the things that's really important that I've advocated for in a stateless society is a fundamental right to equitable access to natural resources. Why is it wrong to put up a fence around 1 million acres and just point guns at everybody who tries to trespass on it, right? If you're not actually using that land, if you're not actually, as Locker said, mixing your labor with natural, if you're not mixing your labor with nature to claim something as property outside of your body, you can't claim a legitimate ownership to that. Now, what Robin is pointing out here is very legitimate, that a voluntary society is not the answer to all of humanity's problems, just 99% of them, right? That in a voluntary society, when we get to that point, there are still going to be property disputes. But the cool thing about a voluntary society is that they can all be resolved non-violently. They can all be resolved by withdrawing support, they can be withdrawn by not doing business with people that you don't like, they can be withdrawn by, excommunicate people, and we're all familiar with all of the various ways. And when we talk about a voluntary society, a lot of people, who's gonna build the roads, right? And the answer is, we're not gonna need roads where we're going, right? We all know that what we're talking about is not just an immediate set of political positions, but a fundamental change in human society and a continued evolution of human nature. And a voluntary society, a stateless society, is not the end point. What we see in this incredible turning point, what I describe as the asymptote of the human experience, I'm glad that you used that. Are we approaching this point of a stateless society and never quite reaching it? No, because this experience of humanity and life right now is exponential. The point at which we abolish the state is gonna be when the last remnants of it are finally voted out of existence or just rendered completely obsolete. The establishment of a voluntary society, the abolition of all institutionalized coercion, is not the end point. No, it is the beginning, and the trends that we value as people who care about freedom because we love humanity, because we want to see people prosper, because we want to see humanity succeed and do well and continue to thrive, that's just the beginning.
All right, I'm going to let Robin respond to that, and then I'm going to ask a couple questions, just because I want to get to some of the questions out there.
I'm going to break something to you guys, you're going to be really upset. None of you believe in absolute property. If you have a house, and you own the land, the land, the footprint of that, right, you could have an absolutist conception of property, whereby T-Mobile has no right to send its electromagnetic waves through over your garden, right? Maybe. Now, some of you would say that's absurd, and you would still support property rights. Some people would say, no, that's absolute. That's actually right. So you should be able to demand as a house owner that T-Mobile spends money to make sure that its electromagnetic waves never cross the air above your garden, right? Now, you see, like, Robin, this is absurd. Yes, it's kind of absurd. But the point is that you can't just say, voluntarism goes with private property. One depends on the other. Because all of these words can reasonably mean different things to different people. So you can always posit a situation where there is some enforcement of some principle based on some definition that to somebody is institutionalized coercion. And describing what a voluntary society would look like, Adam, is not the same as explaining or showing that a society so described can actually stably exist. I always think that's kind of all I need. It's like you're kind of engaging in a black and white kind of fallacy. There's a lot of black and white things here that in the human mind and in the human experience simply are black and white. And since all political systems are only systems in which people participate, they only exist because the people exist, that's hugely problematic. Now, in Anglo history, you then have the problem. I still think I've won the argument already. But if you just want, a little historical side point, then the beginning of the Anglo tradition, the Anglo Saxons, was very libertarian. And the islanders, the Englanders, were getting beaten up by the Vikings. So the original Anglo conception of kingship was actually by consent, and always has been. And it's to defend the realm. So there was an agreement that there would be delegated use of force that was coercive, that then was meted out to generations that followed. Okay? Now, how do you know that under threat from outside, that could never or would never be required to happen? Maybe not, but again, you don't know. And by the way, here we are in the great United States of America, where in 1776 we founded a country in opposition to a tyrannical monarchy. Okay? So we moved in the anarchic direction, in theory, but in theory there's no difference between theory and practice. In practice there is, right? So now we have a president who is more of a monarch than not only exists in the monarchy of my native land, but wields executive power, signs executive orders weekly. You have to go back to James II in the 17th century in England to find an executive order, right? Okay. So again, sacrifice. So what does this tell us? Human nature. You can't just do this all in theory. It turns out that if you acknowledge the psychological impulse for monarchy, and a monarch is what means that there is one person with more power, official or unofficial, than anybody else, right? A disproportionate will and power. It turns out that if instead of trying to match your complex system to a theory, take down a monarch, which is what we did here and we ended up with one, commonly called Obama, right? If you acknowledge it and you give it a silly hat, and you let it exist and then take all its political power away, you end up with less than of a monarchy, right? Than you actually have when you take the monarchy away. Does that make sense? Right? So I'm just putting this out. I'm not saying so we should have a king, but actually, there's a little section in my book that might make you think a little bit. Because this isn't the first time there's been an Anglo Republic,
like with a leader that replaced the king, that went all dictatorial. Like it happened in the 16th century in England. And the way that was resolved is fascinating. Yeah. Okay. The reason I'm telling you this story is that there is just something you may not know about the future, about human nature, about individuals together, potentially under threat, right? I'm just saying you don't know. And I'm saying all of what you say stands out, even without saying that we have to end up on that line. It's kind of like a full stop, right? And in any case, it's not going to help us get to where we need to go. Because if you're wrong, if somebody hears you and you're wrong about the endpoint, they may reject the whole journey. Take my position. You don't have to commit to the endpoint. You can just say, look, we're going in the right direction, and Adam and I will hold hands on that, as we do, right? So, I think I've
done it. All right, so I heard you kind of take the Hoppe position there, that monarchy is preferable to democracy. That's what I'm taking from that.
No, I didn't say that.
Okay. This is a question I'm curious about, given recent political situation. You both answered, but it's kind of towards Adam here. So imagine that you live on a slave plantation. You're a slave and you cannot leave. You're surrounded by other slave plantations. Would it ever make sense to support a strong authoritarian master if the plantation is being threatened by a barbarian horde? Why or why not?
I don't buy a particular part of the premise that you cannot leave, that you cannot hide, that there are no other options.
This is my hypothetical.
I believe your hypothetical is contrary to reality and doesn't apply to the conversation. I think it presents a false limited choice. And I think part of what we understand as free thinkers is that there's always another option. That two wrongs don't make a right. I mean, there are these simple universal truths that do provide principle to a destination. But again, Robin, I believe you're misrepresenting a little bit of what I said here, in that I'm talking about an end state. Humanity is progressing to be less and less violent. There is gonna be, when I say I advocate for a stateless society, I don't even know what that point is. And I think that's an important concession to you in this, Robin, and that I don't know at what point I would say this is a stateless society. I know what I'm going to celebrate, you know. There's going to be some really exciting points along the way, right? But the complete dissolution of all institutionalized coercion is a gradual process. So I'm not answering the question at all, obviously. See, there's another option.
He just conceded. Did you hear that? If you can't define the zero point, you're done. Right? I mean, that's the whole anarchy is the zero point. You can't define it. And you're right. I mean, I think he's just basically the whole thing my way, thanks very much. And it's an extremely realistic idealization, ironically, of the truth, says the guy who spent 12 years and I don't know how many thousand dollars trying to get out of one unfree state, ironically into one slightly less unfree, right? But you can't, there's nowhere left to homestead. I mean, really, not in any practical fashion. So I think it's a reasonable question. I think it does speak very much to the point that I'm trying to make.
All right. Okay. So here's another question I have, and this has. Can you write one down? I've got a pile of questions here from the audience. So but feel free to write one down, and I'll see if they. I won't be able to get to all of them, but. Yeah. Please. Now, if I understand the anarchist position, it's not advocating no rules or chaos, but it's advocating no rulers. And so if that's the case, I hear libertarians always advocate a position of abolish this rule or that rule on the road. Is that the best position to take when it comes to public property, that we advocate for no rules? Or should we be advocating for privatization of that property? I'd like to hear your thoughts on that. And I'd also like to hear your thoughts on how that might relate to questions of immigration and the idea that privatized land would be much more limiting towards, say, barbarian hordes migrating around than the typical open borders position of libertarians.
So the first is, should we have private property or what?
Well, the question is, I guess, the way they relate, and the reason I'm asking is kind of selfish. Now, I told the audience earlier that you know, I
I consider myself an anarchist, but and so these are questions that kind of keep me up at night when I think about things like immigration and different things like that. The question is, given that we are prohibited from owning public, from owning, privatizing the public land, and that if we were to privatize the land, it's likely that we would control our own immigration, that we would invite people that are peaceful and virtuous into association with us, but we would ostracize those that we deem threats. And so it's likely that we would, in an anarcho-capitalist society, see barbarians' migration patterns very limited and virtuous peoples open, wide open, or something like that. You could also relate it to road rules, for example. You know, I don't like drunk drivers. I'm a paramedic. I deal with these guys all the time and, you know, pick up their carnage. Now, I don't want to see necessarily drunk driving laws repealed. I would prefer to see the rules privatized. So that's the way I tend to think about it, but I'm curious to know what your thoughts are and whether, you know, whether the whole debate over open borders versus closed borders is just a red herring to avoid the real discussion, which is should we be privatizing this stuff so we get a proper rule set?
That's a very important question. It's a very important distinction. At the presidential debates last night, the issue of licensing came up. Did everybody catch that? Was that not awesome to see licensing being brought to the forefront as an issue that you don't need government permission to do something that you have a right to do? I mean, that was really cool, but there were some shallow and very imprecise answers on that. And I think the way that Tim phrases the question actually gets to the heart of this. Should you be required for something to have a license to drive? Well, that's up to the owner of the road. How about that, right? It should be based on that private property standard. If I own a road and I want you to prove to me that you have some capability of using it responsibly, then that's up to me. We can make predictions about where this is going to go in a free society. And the idea of private property being the only legitimate definition of any kind of orders is absolutely the correct ethical propertarian position. So to get to the question of the roving hordes of barbarians in a stateless society, right? I mean, that again is sort of like a who will build the roads question, you know? Who will defend us from people from thousands of years ago who believed in crazy primitive belief systems and thought that murder was a really good idea, you know? Like, just, that's the red herring in this. And when we're talking about the stateless society as the objective, it's not, again, an immediate set of policy positions. And I think as an anarchist, for me, there are people who say, you know, anarchy is something that we want tomorrow, we want revolution, we want to smash the state. I don't want to smash the state. Because as a voluntarist anarcho-capitalist, I believe in this because I understand this based on an objective for me of seeing humanity succeed, of seeing a society of greater harmony and greater love. And so the end goal is, you know, what you say, whether it's possible or not, whether or not, if you see that that is the end goal, I think you've conceded, and then you said you agree with the end goal. And there are some caveats to this, to whether or not a stateless society is possible. And we, you know, we got into this the other night. If the sun expands into the earth before we get there, right? If we blow each other up with nuclear weapons first, sure. And my assertion that a stateless society is inevitable is based on the continuing trends that we see in human history and human progress. And if it's, I would concede to you in the sense that I could be wrong. That I could be wrong about the timing. I could be wrong about, hey, maybe Donald Trump or Hillary Clinton's gonna get elected and we're all gonna get blown up. Hey, it's possible, right? So the end goal as a legitimate objective, whether it's achievable or not, shouldn't determine whether you are, you know, which again, you label me, you negate me, right? So I would label, you know, when you say an anarchist or a voluntarist or an anarcho-capitalist, it's, you know, we think of these as like belief systems. You know, like your parents were Republicans and conservatives or liberal Democrats, so you're going to be that, or they were Christian or Buddhist or Jewish or whatever it is. And it's not about that. It's a truth that you accept, a universal standard of ethics, certain things about human nature. And the truth is that we are capable of this, and we should strive towards this, and we should find out if it's possible or not. And I think that's the ultimate point of agreement we're going to come to.
All right, Robin, do you want to respond to that?
You're right. We can... But look, I mean, and thank you for conceding again, Adam, and just to deal with the fact that you mentioned that I conceded to him. Obviously, we both agree on the direction. If we've agreed on the direction, that the direction is to reduce the use of institutionalized coercion, right, then obviously we've agreed that we both want to go towards zero. Right? But the only reason you can, the only distinction between his position and my position is that he's making a claim that you, well, I think Adam's backed off because he's now conceded the debate. But I mean, the only useful definition of anarchism isn't just that we should go there in some ideal world, because in an ideal world, nobody would hurt anyone anyway, so wouldn't that be great? I mean, it hurt. Okay, obviously we can imagine a hypothetical, but the anarchist position, the substantial position is, and we as human beings can get there. Otherwise, it's a meaningless thing, right? Otherwise, it's just another way of, let's all go in the same direction. So no, I think if this debate means anything at all, then no, I didn't concede anything by saying that. But I don't know that answers your original question, too.
I think it does, and I have an additional one. This one is for you to start with, and that is, do you think that it might be... It seems like you agree with Adam in terms of the principles underlying this, the metaphysics, as you put it. But what I wonder is, in terms of the pragmatic issue here, do you think it might be necessary for a criminal gang to exert a territorial claim over a particular territory in order to protect from predators and particularly predatory states nearby?
What do you mean by criminal?
Okay, well, I would use Adam's terminology here. I'm taking, a group of people that violate ethical norms like the non-aggression principle. So a group of people that we would call the state, Adam would just call them probably a criminal gang. And so I'm using his term, but I'm saying even if we accept his premise that the state is a criminal gang, I'm assuming that's your position, then is it possible that we might even need a criminal gang, even if we don't imagine that there's some moral entity called the state to protect us?
The problem is that your question answers itself by the words that you use. Right. The reason the criminal gang was originally formed in Anglo-Saxon England, right, was because there was a generation of people that decided to do this for self-defense, and then people were born into a society that had those institutions that then were legitimized by rules that were prevailing at the time that people more or less bought into. You see, here's the problem. We, Adam and I agree, that very much of what the US government does makes them, for all intents and purposes, a criminal gang. But guess what, folks? We're in a minority, right? Too many. They cannot call them. They don't experience them as, to use your term, a violation of ethical norms. There's something about democracy, the pooling of sovereignty. To most people, that makes tax different from theft, right? Democracy different from tyranny, right? And these are the most people that will populate our society, that will be born into our society. So I refuse the question based on the words, because the words are not neutral, right?
Okay, well let me segue over to Adam then. This is one of the questions someone had. Assuming that there's a territory we could describe as voluntarist or anarchic, surrounded by a bunch of predatory nation states, how would it defend itself? Could it defend itself, or would an equally violent predatory gang need to emerge in order to protect that territory from the surrounding nation states? What are your thoughts?
Your question presumes an anthropomorphic definition of a location. This territory, how could a territory defend itself? I don't know, maybe the trees will come to life and start swatting the invaders away? You're using a false construct in the question itself. And if anything, if you have a stateless society surrounded by states, they're pretty immediately going to see that, hey, people without a state are a lot happier, aren't they? People without a state get along a lot better. Hey, they're not being violently coerced to support a criminal gang. And
One of the important things to point out here is that we have examples of this as well through human history, of relatively stateless societies who defended themselves. And when we talk about a society, now you're talking about not an area, but a group of people, and I think that's to help you with your question a little bit.
My question,
excuse me.
That's okay.
It sounded so Canadian. There's a... So there are, and this is really important in a lot of what I advocate too, because when we talk about the proposition of a stateless society, or even a minimal state, what are you gonna do for national defense, right? And part of the misconception of that is based on the assumption that nations go to war with other nations, or countries go to war with other countries. And we have been so thoroughly propagandized to believe this. Every history lesson about war, even the way that we talk about us, the United States, America, did this. No, that's crap. The government did it, men with guns, people like me, put on uniforms and took a plane to the other side of the world and pointed those guns at real people. Governments use violence to expand their protection rackets. And if you have an area where the people have refused to be governed, like Afghanistan in recent history, like Ireland in ancient history, said, no, it doesn't matter who you are. You are not going to govern us. We are free people. We refuse to be governed. The state neighboring that area has no legitimate interest. It is a losing proposition for them to attempt to control those people. What we are doing in freeing minds with this message is inoculating people against that aggression. Some people ask me, Adam, but without the American military, aren't you worried about China taking over the United States? Well, have you noticed how much of our debt, they own? Have you noticed how much property they are buying in the United States right now? If anything, the American government is making it easier for foreign nations to control the affairs of American citizens by having a government that can be bought and sold. And if anything, having a military actually makes you less safe, not in just all the ways that we know as libertarians lead to bad policy positions and violent, evil military adventures, but in the fact that having a military sends a very strong signal to those neighboring states. Those are people who don't mind being taxed to support a violent gang. They will support a military. And a military cannot exist without the support of a broader population. To return to the idea of the invading barbarians. If you don't have the support of your neighbors, of your community, it makes it really hard to say, hey, you know, that being productive thing we've all been doing, you know, helping each other and growing food for each other and making stuff for each other and providing services that we want to consume. Hey, I'm going to stop doing that and I'm going to go kill some people and take their stuff. Can somebody just make food and clothes for me while I'm doing this? You see, it doesn't work. And the premise of a stateless society is not, hey, we just abolish government, but that the paradigm fundamentally shifts. And if I may bring it back to the main narrative here, because we're going to just ignore the questions and go back and forth.
Because
right?
We're anarchists?
Yeah, sorry, exactly. Oh! That's the concession right there. He labeled and negated himself. All right, no, but Robin, I do think, and again, this might be getting to definitions, but more about what an ism is and what a label is. And I'm glad that you mentioned that in your opening here, because in labeling someone an anarchist or a minarchist or a voluntarist or whatever, in a sense, you are talking, you could even define how much do those labels apply. Like, as you could say, well, I'm a minarchist, because you could, if minarchist defines what you believe in as immediate policy change, I'm a minarchist. But if it means what you believe in is the end goal is the ideal state, heck no. Human beings should not be ruling other people, and we are evolving past this primitive practice. And if you say that is the end point, even if we may never reach it, I would say the label applies to you.
All right, gentlemen, we've got 10 minutes left, so I think we have to get close to wrapping up. But I would...
Can we have a lightning round for the benefit of people who vote?
Sure, okay, let's do this. All right, Robin, can the state exist absent delusions about the use of force? I believe it would be, delusion would be like non-subscribing to the non-initiation of force. So if everyone subscribed to the non-initiation of force, could the state exist? Do you want to take that one?
Okay, but the question had delusion in, the word delusion in, and who defines delusion?
All right, fair enough.
In the sense of delusion in that it would be ethical to use force in a certain way that would violate us, yes, I think it does require a delusion, and I think the appropriate way of understanding that is in the delusions that are used to manipulate the enforcement class to be able to do violence against peaceful people on behalf of authority.
Okay, then. So...
Yes.
Okay. It is a fact, and if we have more time, we can give hundreds of examples, that people come up with legitimate, with decision-making processes that they feel legitimizes the establishment of coercive force for a particular purpose. If you say that's delusional, that's an awful lot of collective human activity that is going on, perfectly consistent with happy, with the nature of happy human beings, that is all delusional. So I think that would be a very hard, that'd be a very hard thing to claim.
Okay, what is the glue that holds society together and makes minimal government, voluntary free market government, and zero government possible?
Glue that holds society together. I don't use glue to connect with other people. So just definitions here, obviously this is metaphorical. It's the paradigm that defines the social organization. It's how people think that defines what organization is, determines how that society comes together.
Our pursuit of happiness, given our nature, determines what makes us happy.
Okay, Robin, if we agree that a person is born with certain inalienable rights, such as life, liberty, and property, then where did the right to take those rights without someone's consent come from?
He's not that kind of anarchist.
You can't take. There is no right to take life, liberty, or the pursuit of happiness. As we have seen, property, the definition of property, is problematic, and also a problem for libertarians, does depend on agreement, right? So, again, problems in the question.
All right, Adam, in many ways, nature is amoral. You often speak about modern society transcending towards a more anarchist society. How do you feel about transhumanism and technologies correcting nature's amoral defaults?
I don't think there's a problem with nature being amoral. It simply is, and what we superimpose on that is our view of that. What technology is doing is empowering us to essentially be more human, to live higher by our standards of values, of love and cooperation and harmony. And I'm a big fan of transhumanism. I will be the second one to put a chip in my brain and a camera in my eyeball. I think all these things are incredibly empowering, and it's very exciting. I think it's important to face the reality of how these technologies interact with the paradigm today and how we interact with each other, and to be able to look forward and see that technology is fundamentally empowering and empowers us to get what we want. And what we all want is to live free, to have our individual will respected, and to be able to love ourselves and love others.
Robin, in both an anarchist and minarchist society, the rights of the individual are protected. Do the rights of the people extend only as far as nature allows? Is the earth with unlimited resources to humankind and our rights superior?
Are our
rights superior?
To the earth?
Take the last line. Take off the last line.
Okay, so the question then is, in both an anarchist and minarchist society, the rights of the individual are protected. Do the rights of the people extend only as far as nature allows?
Okay, again, problematic question, because if something can, if nature, i.e. reality, only allows something to go so far, then by definition, it can only go so far.
Okay, I suspect there'll be a conversation here afterwards to clarify. Adam says he wants to see property use, but who defines whether or not property is being used? Would simply enjoying the view be a sufficient use for land? What if technology is invented that permits property to be used in a new way, i.e. fracking? Must that technology be employed to use the property?
That That is a great question and so important in looking forward to a stateless society. And one of the things that we get to establish in a stateless society is a socially acceptable standard of what is homesteading, what is a property right, you know? And this is essential to me, and it is subjective in how we look forward and what happens in different areas. So if, for example, I go out, I just bought 10 acres in Arizona, I'm building a house, fully off-grid, self-sustaining, Earthship-style home. I only got 10 acres because I'm very confident that well into the future, 10 acres will be an appropriate individual homesteading allotment, and then no one will say, well, hey, Adam, you're not using that little corner of your property. You really have to cede that to me. You can't defend that. You're not using it. I'm going to squat on it. But in the future, in a more populated world, perhaps, if someone is, again, fencing off 1 million acres and saying, no, you can't use this because I'm raising cattle here, well, in order for them to really continue to do that, say you put up a fence around 1 million acres, you're grazing cattle, and there are people around that area who are homeless. There are people around there who could use those resources better than you could. Then the market will not support your cattle operation and buy your meat. And by the way, this is probably happening in a world where we can 3D print food at a molecular level, so all of this is irrelevant. Anyway, if you say, hey, I'm going to fence off 1 million acres to raise cattle, people are going to go, you're freaking nuts, and no one is going to support that business. You are not going to be able to hire anyone to point guns at people to keep them off that property. So this new frontier of establishing what is an appropriate standard, that's the new debate. That's beyond statism. That's a new world, and that is so exciting that we get to have that conversation after we end the state, as we're ending the state, and that we get to see a world where all of those conflicts are resolved peacefully in voluntary actions, not through essential violent authority.
I love all the stuff that Adam says, but again, it's description of a future reality that I'm sure all of us in this world would love. But it's not that it can only exist in a purely stateless society, whatever that is. Let's just be clear, these wonderful descriptive statements do not argue for the possibility of a stable anarchic equilibrium. And by the way, if we're going to establish this in our homeland, pretty much every single bit of this land was privatized in violation of the non-aggression principle. So how do you deal with them apples, right? You know, if someone's going to be born into the state of society where there is this private property and object because he's completely consistent with libertarian philosophy, traces back the original ownership to an act of aggression, and there's nowhere else you can trace it back to, then he's got every right to say, nah. Right, you're not buying it, and he's going to walk across that field. Now, I'm not saying he's right in doing that, but again, it just ain't that simple. There's always a basis to feel that you are being aggressed against according to, you used the word ethical norms at some point, one of you used the word ethical norms of society, which right there is problematic, because by our current society's ethical norms, that's a really problematic standard. You know, this democracy is just great, and taxes aren't coercive. I mean, that's the norm of our society. But anyway, that's
response. Advocating for a stable society is not advocating for a stable equilibrium. It is advocating for human progress. And it is a progress that will continue after the abolition of the state. There will be more progress towards more harmony. There will be more progress towards better understanding of what is an appropriate standard of homesteading and owning property. And I think this is incredible to see that we will have a vibrant society. We will continue to have competition. We will continue to have debates and conversations about these things. It's not that there will no longer be a political conversation in the sense that we get to come together as a society. It's going to be totally different. It's going to happen all online, obviously. There's maybe not all, but there's going to be a totally different way in which these consensuses are come to on what is appropriate standards for property rights. It's not a stable equilibrium. It is continued progress. It will have its ups and downs, its steps forward and its steps backwards, but it's about progress towards better ways of resolving those disputes. And eventually we will figure out ways to eliminate all of the violent, coercive ways to resolve the property disputes, which is really a big part of what this conversation comes down to, is the various applications of what is property and then what is an ethical defense of it.
So one sentence to explain myself on the stable equilibrium. I was just referring to the zero of the amount of government. Right? If we're going to be for anarchism, if we're going to be anarchists, we have to believe that once you get to zero, you can stay at zero. Right? You can't go below zero, and we don't want to go back up again. right? Because then it's looking not an anarchic society. So when I was talking about state equilibrium, I was referring specifically to that particular zero size of the state.
All right, last question, gentlemen. What, if anything, can government do better than the free market?
Nothing.
Now or in the future?
Well, talk about now.
Well, you know, I hate labels, right? But if you made me come up with one, you know, on a kind of a news show, right, just going out to normal Americans, well, the libertarians, I might call myself a constitutionalist, right, and admit government. And I would say that, given what the founders gave us, there is a role today for dealing with negative externalities. I think it's the general answer.
All right. Well,
negative
externalities.
No, like as in negative economic externalities, right?
Protecting negative rights.
No. Negative externalities is, I make widgets and I pollute the river in the process of doing that, and that negatively affects people who were not involved in the widget buying or making transaction. There's a third party that gets hurt. Right, in our system, given where the market reaches now, where government reaches now, not only is that appropriate use of government, that's the constitutional use of government kind of in general.
Objection, appeal to authority.
All right, well, you know, I'm not 100% sure that we had a debate here tonight. I'm not sure there was a disagreement at all. Let me pull the audience. Was anybody swayed from their original position? Let's say, was anyone who was an anarchist swayed towards minarchy by Robin's argument? All right, we got two. One and a half. He's kind of agnostic like you are about the whole thing. Okay, what about the other way around? Is there any minarchist that might have been swayed over to the anarchist position? Okay, we've got...
You stubborn people.
You trained both my friends.
Three.
Can I embrace the end?
Okay, embrace the end.
I felt like both of them were, could be applied. One is an ideal philosophy and the other is a practical approach. And you can embrace and simultaneously. Is that not?
You can do what you want, man. You're free. All right, well, I'd like to thank you all for attending. I'd like to thank the two debaters tonight. I'm sure that these gentlemen will be around to chat and answer questions. Enjoy the evening.
Best debater weekend.
I'm figuring out to buy my book if you're interested. $20 signed and delivered.